Let's discuss what I call bulletproof retail strategy. There are 108 retail channels in all of retail. Ask yourself the question, what is your lowest hanging fruit? Which channel is the home for your product? Your product most likely doesn't belong in one channel, but there is probably just one or two channels that are the best opportunity for success. That's where your best sell-through is going to come from. If you're just starting a brand or thinking about starting a brand, here's some advice. Pick a product that can be sold to multiple channels. An example of what not to do is to find a product that only belongs in one channel. Think about an office chair, for an example. There is a very limited number of stores you can sell this to, and realistically, only one real channel, office supplies. Your chance for success in selling this product all hinges on getting into just one of a couple stores that even exist. Compare that to something like wearable tech, something that could be sold to the sporting goods, to the outdoor, to the consumer electronics, to water sport, to surf, and many other channels. Your chance of growing a successful brand in wearable tech is so much greater than one of creating an office chair. It's critically important to data mine the information of the buyers you're going to be contacting. Let me give you a very important tip. Don't purchase and don't use a purchased organized list sold by a third party. Bad data will blacklist your URL. It'll completely ruin all of your outreach for everything else you do for your company. Spend the necessary time data mining. And if you're not going to data mine, use Ant Hill Retail. At Ant Hill Retail, last year alone, we spoke to 33,000 retail buyers of the 105,000 active buyers in our system. That is 31% of the total active buyers that we found in US retail. If you know other brands that have had success selling to certain stores, work with that brand. Identify who those buyers are. Make the hard phone calls to the corporate offices. Ask the operators who the buyers are. You may have to guess their email address formats for that company. That's okay. It will take time. Do the necessary work. Let me tell you the best method of getting your product out there fast. It's a very romantic idea to sell to a very targeted, specific retail outlet. However, this is not the best practice for selling to retail. I highly recommend blasting to all channels and getting on the radar for all the specific buyers that you plan on selling to. You want to get on all the calendars of all the different buyers because they will all purchase at different times in the year. Blast to channels, find out what the opportunities are first. You can always decide later if they're a good fit for your company. At least start the dialogue. Here's a recommended tip. If you want a buyer to respond to your brand, loop in their colleagues. A colleague referral from one of their coworkers is going to get a response to your brand 100% of the time. I'm going to give you an example of the best performing initial outreach for a brand that we've run in our system. Check out this email that we had for Invigorate. Take note of the subject bar. It has a call to action, attention, essential oil, GM buyer. There's no spammy content in this. This is a professional business to business email. This tells the buyer immediately that you know the industry, you know the category names of the buyers. The second part of the subject bar, our essential oil laptop and car diffuser, tells them exactly what the product is before they even open up the email. Check out the body of the email. It is quick and is simple. It is one paragraph long. It calls out specifically the retailer's name. Only a few lifestyle photos are found within the body of the email. It ends with a call to action. If you could refer me to the appropriate buyer, I would greatly appreciate it. This email received 72 responses from over 50 different chains in a matter of only 3 hours. Let's go over the best practices for the subject bar. Use the appropriate vocabulary for the industry. Use terms like category manager or buyer. Use buzzwords like slot in, review date, POG review. We've included these in the resource section of this course. Another good practice for the subject bar is identifying expected sell-through rates per store per week. You may want to put a specific day of the week in the subject bar. It's a call to action. You may want to put a phrase like our conversation history so far. This prompts the buyer to open up the email. You may want to call out a specific date when you know the review is happening. A good tip would be something like call request, Friday. You may want to outline conversation history. Do not make this gimmicky or spammy. You're not offering 20% off of anything. Stay away from exclamation points or the words off, or the word sell. If you put the word sell or put an exclamation point, it's going to end up in their junk folder and they're not going to open it. Now we're going to talk about best email practices. Only 24% of sales emails are opened. Here's a tip. Use Boomerang. See what buyers are opening your email and what the frequency is. Emails written at a third grade reading level are 36% more likely to get a reply than those written at a college reading level. Subject lines with 3 to 4 words are the most effective in getting responses. Don't just provide information in the email and on calls, request for information too. These emails have a 50% higher likelihood to move the dialogue. Always request information. Ask when the category review date is. Ask when they'll be making decisions. Ask how many total products they're going to be cutting out of their planogram and how many they're going to be adding to their planogram. Boldly and kindly, ask them if you can send them samples and to what address you should send them to. How do you eat an elephant? You do it one bite at a time. Sales are made phone call by phone call, email by email, trip by trip. There is no replacing hard work. You need to get on the radar of every single buyer. So when your product review comes, you're on the top of their mind. It's critically important to share new content with them every single week. Trickle out your PR wins or every single time you pick up a new chain. You need to change up the content every 1 to 2 weeks. Buyers know when you have a stagnant brand. Don't become that brand. If your product requires heavy marketing, you're going to have to start with a specific region in the United States if you can't afford a nationwide launch. Here's what I recommend. Reach out to the entire channel or multiple channels. Then, after you know which retailers are interested in you, then pick the top 2 or 3 in that region to roll with. Throw your marketing dollars into that specific tight region where the end consumers can be bombarded by your brand. Make sure your sell-through is high with that retailer before moving on to other regions with other retailers. What size of retailers should you be going after? That totally depends on the budget of your brand. At Ant Hill, we deal with brands that are very well capitalized. We also deal with brands that just aren't there yet. That's okay. Big, well-established brands have the luxury of just going after mom-and-pop boutiques and having a really dialed-in, sophisticated strategy. Most brands, however, need cash flow, and they need cash flow now. In this scenario, go straight to the large retailers, get capital, and then move on to the smaller chains. I'm going to give you a tip on how to build momentum so buyers take you serious. In retail, buyers want to know who else is coming to the party. Share with them your social media wins, your influencer wins, your PR wins. Tell them of stores that you've landed recently. If you've been promoted on a local or national PR outlet, share those wins. With many of the best-selling brands that I've been a part of, we didn't have much sales at the very beginning. It took a long time feeding good wins until the buyers took us seriously. I remember a conversation I had with one of the buyers at HEB Grocery. Their reply was simply, "Okay, you've convinced us. Here's the vendor setup docs." Simply said, in the HEB example, we wore them down. This buyer committed to us simply because she knew we weren't going away. She knew that other people were excited about us too. I'm going to introduce to you now the best practices when calling a retail buyer. We've done some fantastic studies here at Ant Hill Retail. We found out that it takes 18 phone calls to make a sale in retail. That's a lot of effort. There's no shortcuts here. Depending on the channel, it might take 6 phone calls to actually get a hold of a buyer and have a meaningful dialogue. Get to know the buyer on a personal level, on scheduled follow-up calls. Use the first 2 to 3 minutes to get to know their likes and their interests. Build that relationship. It's going to give you so much better of an advantage the next time you talk to them if you have reference points of your previous discussion. Buyers are extremely busy. Ask them at the beginning of each call, how are they doing on time? Buyers greatly appreciate that you have awareness of their busy lives. Use collaborative words like we, us, our, and together. Those are 10 times more effective in closing than using words like you, I, me, or your. Writing a detailed recap to a buyer after a phone call greatly increases your chance to land the sale. Let's talk about sample policy. you have 48 hours at most to ship off a sample that's been requested from a buyer. We see examples of brands all the time that simply don't take the time and effort to ship off samples in a timely manner. If this is the case with your product, change that as quick as you can. This is the easiest thing to fix with the greatest return. Send them tracking information on the sample. Here's a great tip. The moment that you receive notification that sample did arrive to that buyer, email the buyer and let them know. A buyer has tons of samples that have arrived in their offices. Get them aware that your product is in their offices now. Don't send damaged boxes. Make sure that you have packing peanuts and that the presentation is sharp. Separate yourself from all the other products being sampled that day. Check out the resource section to see other great examples of sample boxes. Now that you've started the dialogue with the buyer and they've received samples, let's figure out the next steps. This is the best time to ask questions. Figure out what sells well in their sets and what does not. Figure out how many products are going to be deleting and how many they anticipate picking up. Ask them about new trends in specific product categories. Ask them about products that are trending down as well. Let's discuss vendor docs and order forms. They range widely in retail. Some retail outlets that are small won't require vendor docs. Just a couple of pages about your company profile will do. Other larger retail outlets require very substantial and in-depth vendor docs. Don't worry and don't get scared. The majority of the information found in these vendor docs is not required. Be brave and ask the buyer what's important information and what is not. Fill out the most important information first and then ask the buyer if there's anything else. The odds are you can save hours upon hours in not filling out unnecessary parts of the vendor docs. This is bulletproof retail strategy. It helps you get identified by the buyers, it helps you be taken serious by the buyers, and it helps you land that specific account.